This week on The Wheelhouse. Immigration. Fear-mongering. And misinformation. For Connecticut Public, I'm Frankie Graziano. This is The Wheelhouse, show that connects politics to the people. We got your weekly dose of politics in Connecticut and beyond right here. You caught last Tuesday's presidential debate. You heard a lot about immigration. It's an issue that both candidates, Vice President Kamala Harris and former President Donald Trump, have prioritized in their political platforms. But with so much information, misinformation flying around about immigration, it can be hard to separate fact from fiction. Our guests today are here to help us out with just that. Joined this morning by Maria Sacchetti, reporter for the Washington Post covering immigrant communities and immigration and customs enforcement. Maria, so good to see you there on Zoom. Welcome to The Wheelhouse.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, thank you so much for coming on. And Charles Venator-Santiago. Charles, the associate professor at the joint appointment in the Department of Political Science and El Instituto. Thank you so much for coming on at the University of Connecticut, Charles Venator-Santiago.
Hi, Frankie. Good to see you.
Questions. You folks have questions about immigration or about some of the things you're hearing about immigration. Join the conversation, 888-720-9677. We really would welcome your phone calls. And a hello to our friends on TikTok as we are live on TikTok. TikTok at CT Public on TikTok. Hey, former President Donald Trump says that immigrants crossing the border are causing an uptick in crime here in the United States. I wanted to better understand that theory. So I talked to somebody about it. I talked to Gustavo Solis, investigative border reporter at KPBS in San Diego. Here's what he had to say about what Donald Trump calls a migrant crime wave.
The reason it's so popular is because it touches on people's very real and legitimate insecurities. If we're thinking about what we care about during the election and what impacts us directly, I think our personal safety is near the top of the list. But the data doesn't really prove that, right? And we can look at multiple data points, right? The first one is just looking at crime rates overall in the country. They're going down. Study after study shows people born in the U.S. are much more likely to be arrested and convicted of crimes compared to people who were not born in the U.S.
Maria, Gustavo is saying that not only is there not a migrant crime wave, it's actually not even a crime wave at all. Is this something you've looked into as well? And can you respond to some of what he said?
We have looked into that at the Washington Post and where I used to work at the Boston Globe. And there's different studies. I mean, Gustavo was right that the evidence doesn't show that. And there's been multiple different kinds of studies. One of the issues is that police don't really collect this information. It's very inconsistent. And so, it's difficult to say definitively. But there's been just so many different kinds of studies trying to take a look at this. And you know, scholars say it just doesn't add up. I mean, immigrants tend to be self-selected. They can tend to come here seeking a better life, not to commit crimes. There's always going to be people who commit crimes in any group. But focusing on immigration as a cause of that, kind of takes us away from other issues that may cause things like drinking and driving or domestic violence or things like that, that are much broader issues and more likely to come up.
It's a very good point. I appreciate that perspective from you, Maria. I just wanted to ask Charles here, since he covers immigration and get some data and also works with students at the University of Connecticut locally. We just heard from somebody on the West Coast. Help us understand how this kind of rhetoric is impacting folks in Connecticut, immigrants here in Connecticut, and people that are also not just, let's talk about immigrants, but also people that might be here from a different country that are here legally.
Yeah, no, so it's really interesting, and I agree completely with what both colleagues said. And this, the evidence is also in incarceration rates. It just doesn't bear the evidence that immigrants are particularly Latino immigrants are committing crimes. One of the problems that we're seeing in Connecticut is that this national rhetoric of the Mexican or Central American or Venezuelan rapist and murderer is now being used essentially to describe Puerto Ricans and Latinos. We saw that case in Meriden some time ago where two landscapers were simply working and some presumably Trumpists decided to accuse them of being undocumented immigrants because they were speaking Spanish. So we're seeing that sort of echoed across the state in different kinds of instances.
It's a very difficult environment when you're all of a sudden in this show me your papers kind of environment, which is obviously a scary place. And Maria, here locally, Connecticut has a significant Haitian population. It's growing. Former President Donald Trump made comments about Haitian immigrants, specifically during the debate. One comment stemmed from this accident that happened over a year ago in Springfield, Ohio. I just want to get into it a little bit. 11-year-old boy killed when a Haitian immigrant's minivan crashed into a school bus. Donald Trump and his running mate, J.D. Vance, have run wild with it, using it as an example of the threat that immigrants pose. Donald Trump infamously now during that debate went on to repeat the false story that Haitian immigrants in Ohio are eating people's, I want to make sure I get this right, pet dogs and cats. So that's right. Where we're at.
I mean, there are certainly, and you know, there are individual tragedies throughout the country that people have, that some politicians, Trump included, have focused on. This is part of his playbook. This is something he did in 2015, 2016, when he highlighted individual crimes committed by immigrants. Now, of course, other people commit those same crimes, and you don't see certain politicians bringing those up. I mean, that is a legitimate question for them, I think. I'm not on the campaign trail, but I think those are the kinds of the questions that are important to ask. The other thing is Haitians in particular are a very diverse group among themselves, right? So to focus on individual situations, I think is challenging. You know, Haitians have fled political persecution. There's been U.S. intervention in that country. They have this is for decades. Most Haitians in the United States, there's about 800,000 of them, are U.S. citizens now. And so, you know, there's a focus, as always, you know, on the people who are newly arriving. But, you know, these folks are Americans for the most part. And they're part of a much broader community of 45 million immigrants in the United States, and more than half of them are U.S. citizens. They vote, they serve on juries, they're doctors, lawyers, landscapers, what, you know, doing all kinds of work across the country. So immigrants are a much more complex group than what a lot of people are seeing in the news or on the campaign trail.
Shout out to our Haitian friends in Connecticut, a large Haitian population in southern Connecticut. I talked to Susan Snitzer, who is the CEO and president of Connecticut Institute for Refugees and Immigrants, earlier this week. Susan confirmed that Connecticut has a significant Haitian population, as I said. Siri helps folks secure work authorization cards, find jobs. They offer an English language learning program. Susan addressed some of the rhetoric being used about Haitian immigrants and talked about how it impacts her work.
Part of that work is when we do have clients who are hearing any type of negative rhetoric about folks from their home country or others that relates to immigration, is really talking through that with our clients and letting our clients know that just because a group or certain people are saying things that are disparaging, that is not how we feel as a state, that's not how we feel as a country, and that's certainly not who we are as an organization.
Charles, any thoughts on what Susan just shared with us?
Yeah, no, so when I look at Haitian migration, you have to think about this as a triangular migration, because a lot of Haitians go to Dominican Republic. Moving to the United States is a bigger jump. I sometimes think this is a racial targeting. In other words, there's the perception that Haitians are black immigrants and therefore they're more likely to be criminals. Although we're seeing some of that with Venezuelans lately in the Trump rhetoric. But I wonder whether this is just an exaggerated, you know, persecution, not persecution, but yeah, in some ways persecution of Haitians, because there's a perception that they're black immigrants.
Charles, though, as you will know, sometimes migration now is driven by the weather, and we have climate evacuees, as we did from Puerto Rico in 2017. Some folks that are coming here from Haiti came here after the devastating tsunami. I spoke to folks in Stanford afterwards, telling us that there's just no jobs down there. So, I mean, there's just people just might not understand the perception. And sometimes we're not even talking about people that are immigrants. Sometimes we're, as you're mentioning, poking fun at people of color.
Yeah, well, so there's climate displacement, there's economic displacement. There's a lot of insecurity in Haiti right now. There's been destabilized government, but there's a lot of economic migration also, again, to the Dominican Republic. And I don't want to minimize migration to the United States, but I think we have to sort of contextualize that the living conditions in Haiti have been destabilized for not recent years, but rather for the past 30, 40 years, in large measure because of our own policies supporting dictators in the Dominican Republic, particularly Papa Doc, Baby Doc, and the list of other dictators that came after. So in some ways, I think we also have to own responsibility on how we create the conditions and in some ways force people to migrate to the United States, which is perceived as a safer space.
We have a phone call that I'd like to get to right now. We have Diana Millette Rivalu, who's going to join us right now, part of a group known as Haitian Community Center of Stanford, currently with the Haitian American Collaborative. And I also want to say a former council member in the city of Norwalk. Diane, thank you so much for coming on the show this morning and talking with us.
Oh, I thank you for having me, Diana. I thank you for having me. Is it okay to just start?
Yeah, just come on in and react to some of the stuff that you heard. Go ahead.
Yeah, so perfect. So a lot of what I heard, I did appreciate, about that we are deeply ingrained in the American culture. There's a lot of us who are Americans, but there's also a space and place that a lot of us also even want the ability to still be Haitian, right? We've lived through this in America. We've been segregated before. We've also been removed from our deep involvement in American history. So I kind of would say that this is a double-edged sword in what was originally said currently with the provoking language that maybe caused a lot of wounds to reopen from back to being told that we were the reason that AIDS came to America to now being facilitated on possibly eating animals. It's just the situation that would even bring that. So what I would say is quickly, Haitians have a strong resound and resolve, right? Although we ask for people to truly persecute the word, but just like the other communities around us, this would have even became policy that would protect the Haitian community, right? Also, in a broader spectrum, even coming into America, becoming citizens or whatever, we have probably the hardest humanitarian parole program situation to become legal in America, and we still go through that process. We have holdups needing for against sponsorship. When we do, we have the inability to return again to our homeland. So, and the funding for it is completely disproportionate to our fellow immigrant brothers, such as someone like that came from Ukraine, right? So I plead for everyone in your outrage to understand that this doesn't just stop here and that you've heard about stories from Haiti that doesn't show the true aspect of the Americans and the Haitians that we are, right? So I ask everyone that at this moment now, if you're enraged, don't just make it a moment to be mad, but make it a moment to put mm-hmm. your voice, your policies, your practices, your money, whatever, and your vote. However you see that vote to be, that strongly impacts us as a whole. But where would we want in America for anyone to have to be in a situation that there's not enough resources that you would even be considered to eat any type of outlandish animal? Like, that's really the ideal, right? Just like right now, food is completely too high, housing high. This is a bit of the distraction on what would actually constitute these words or those ideals. If we were in a situation that wouldn't even provoke it, you wouldn't even thought it. It would just been like hearsay, ha ha ha, right? So there's a lot of anger, but I want it to be not in vain, yeah. Right? Words can be just as powerful as they are damaging. Right. And also our reactions to words. If you have someone who's next to you and for years has been a Haitian friend of yours, and all of a sudden today you look at them different, I really want you to assess yourself and how you're looking at your fellow brethren. You know, how do we look at each other as Americans, right? Because then we're then turning around and saying we need principles and practices and someone to run us, but we're not saying ourselves, how do we see ourselves as Americans? Would we be okay to anyone to call anyone out as American in this manner?
Diana Revoluce is a formal city councilwoman in Norwalk. Thank you so much for calling. Thank you so much for your perspective, Diana.
I appreciate you all. Have a great one. Thank you so much for having me. Your house is amazing.
Thank you, Diana. Our hearts are with you at this time. Hey, I just wanted to now kind of throw it to Charles. About a fifth of Connecticut's population is Latino. Have you seen examples of the, quote, dangerous immigrant rhetoric harming the Latino community? I guess you shared it earlier when you were talking about those folks that were working down in Meriden. Even maybe non-immigrants facing this at all? What do you got?
So Puerto Ricans are U.S. citizens at birth.
I'm sorry. You know, I find it funny because we have these discussions all the time, Charles. That's why. But yes, people forget that Puerto Rico is a part of the United States. Yes.
But this is a really important issue because I think there's a tendency to homogenize all Spanish speakers. And we're seeing that in housing discrimination. We're seeing that in a lot of the complaints that in the focus groups that we're conducting in the community, where people are essentially being described as Mexican criminals, regardless of their national heritage, and regardless of their citizenship. So this national rhetoric, it tends to sort of become representative of the sort of discrimination that a lot of Latinos experience in Connecticut.
Maria, another common thing we hear is the idea that our country is being flooded through illegal border crossings. The stats align with that statement?
I mean, we don't use those terms, you know. I mean, are people crossing the border illegally? Yes, you know, they have been for a long time. And one of the issues, just to put the flip side of this, one of the frustrations I think people have is people are coming to the United States and they're not eligible for asylum. They're coming to work. And that's because, and for example, even Haitians, you know, a lot of Haitians fled Haiti for South America after the 2010 earthquake, which was devastating. I mean, I covered that. It was absolutely horrific. But they're coming, they went to places like Chile or Brazil, and now they're coming to the United States. Now, there's real questions about whether they'll be eligible for asylum. And the system's so backlogged right now, it takes years to get a decision. So by the time they're rejected, you know, they're already really part of the fabric of this society. And so it's creating this real conundrum for future lawmakers who are going to have to deal with it. And they haven't shown that much willingness to solve the issue in the past four decades. So the folks who are here on this tenuous status, it's really unclear what kind of future they have in this country. But in the past couple of months, to more directly answer your question, you know, border crossings have been much lower.
It's not 20 million, right? I guess that's the point, Maria, that we heard in the debate. It's not 20 million.
But it has been millions. It has been the highest, you know, like monthly numbers we've seen. I mean, there are big numbers. And I know people downplay that, but when you look at the journey that people are making, it's a horrific journey. It's a dangerous journey. You're seeing more children than ever. And that's the big question isn't there another way? And, you know, the Congressional Budget Office has found that this unexpected influx of several million people has actually boosted the economy. And the U.S. has had a more robust response to, you know, after COVID, you know, economic rebound than any other country. And so the United States needed workers and people are coming. You see the shelters, you see all these things. But I was talking to people I met at the border, in the aftermath of the pandemic, and they have more jobs than they can do. You know, they're plumbers, they're laying tile, they're doing all kinds of work. And that I think is the thing to think about. A lot of the Venezuelans who are getting a lot of attention, part of the reason they're in the shelters, Haitians too, but particularly Venezuelans, is they don't have contacts in this country, come from an authoritarian country. They're waiting for the government to tell them what to do. You know, when 2019, when we saw tons of people crossing the border under the Trump administration, you didn't see this kind of shelter situation. And why was that? It's because it was kind of a self-run operation. People were arriving with their cousins' numbers like written on their arm. They knew where they were going. They were from Guatemala, from Honduras, you know, had a lot of people here already. And that's what, you know, Venezuelans, you didn't have as much. Maybe in the future, now that so many people have arrived, you would have that. But there's been a, you know, it's been a really different operation this time.
I appreciate you pointing out the fact that it's boosted the economy. We're hearing that a lot in Springfield, Ohio, where we have this kind of national rhetoric, where we're hearing from local officials. We're even hearing from the governor of Ohio saying that immigration seems to be boosting the local economy. Just want to say again, hello to our friends on TikTok. And I want to remind folks that if you want to talk with Maria, Charles, and I, you can give us a phone call, 888-720-9677, 888-720-9677. Charles, I spoke with Gustavo Solis from KPBS about how geography can play a role in how we think about border issues. For instance, up in Connecticut, we're pretty far removed from border states. So here's what Gustavo had to say to kind of give me a little perspective there.
You know, it's one thing to live in San Diego. We see these issues day in, day out. I think there's a lot of fear in the unknown, right? And if you're in a state that's not along the border, you're going to hear about these issues and you may not know them or be confronted by them. And you're going to maybe feel a little bit more scared than you normally would. So I think doing a little bit of the work yourself, going through not just news reports, but organizations like Cato Institute, you know, independent think tanks and policy analysts who are reviewing this stuff, just arm yourself with knowledge and education. And that might alleviate a little bit of the concern and anxiety you're feeling about border issues.
You heard Gustavo there mention the Cato Institute. They're a public policy research organization, think tank, that creates a presence for and promotes libertarian ideas in policy debates. Charles, curious to hear if you have any thoughts on what Gustavo said there.
Let me say two points on Maria's comments that I think are really important to highlight.
Yes.
And I'll return to this. I mean, last time we looked at this, there was room to absorb almost 100 million more immigrants to improve the economy. In the case of the United States, immigrants are actually creating jobs for undereducated Americans who now become managers of a lot of these immigrants who are coming into the country. In the case of Connecticut in particular, we have an aging population that's moving out of the labor force, and immigrants are filling, particularly Latinos, are filling that gap in the labor force in ways that contribute incredibly to the economy because they're not earning enough to save. So they're spending whatever they're earning. Now, in the case, the geographical issues, I think it's really interesting because Connecticut is a pass-through state. So we're seeing a lot more people that are coming to New York, are finding the cost of living too expensive, or are arriving in Massachusetts, and then they're starting to settle in Connecticut. So we're seeing an incredible growth of the Latino population, but we're not seeing the crime rates that people sort of talk about. Well, yes, there is some crime, and yes, there are some Latinos committing crimes, but overall, we're seeing a lot more economic stability and Latinos trying to become small entrepreneurs, trying to sort of join the economy and contribute in whatever ways they can.
I appreciate that very much. I appreciate that you got me finally on speaking about Puerto Ricanos and immigration there. I forgot that the people that you were mentioning in Meriden, I guess we're Puerto Ricano, right?
Yeah.
So you got me there finally. Oh my God. So good to talk to Charles Venator-Santiago. He's going to stay here for another segment. And so is Maria Sacchetti. We're exploring false narratives about immigration. I'm Frankie Graziano. This is The Wheelhouse. After the break, we'll move from fiction to fact. What's actually happening at our borders, and where do our presidential candidates stand on major immigration issues? And just a reminder for folks that if you're feeling targeted or disparaged by misinformation out there, there are resources you can turn to, like the Connecticut Institute for Refugees and Immigrants. Their website is siri.org. SiriCT.org, SiriCT.org, C-I-R-I-C-T.org. Join the conversation. Stick with us on The Wheelhouse, 888-720-9677, 888-720-9677.
Support comes from Innovation Arts and Entertainment, presenting An Evening with David Sedaris September 30th at the Schubert Theater and October 8th at the Bushnell. Stories, Q&A, and book signing. Tickets at davidsedarisontour.com/CT.
On the next Fresh Air, TV journalist Connie Chung, in a new memoir, Chung details her climb to the top of her male-dominated field, her love of hard news, and her nearly 40-year marriage to tabloid talk show host Maury Povich. She also talks about the state of TV news today. Join us.
Listen today at noon.
Does your business need a boost? Connecticut Public adds a dose of trust to make your sponsorship stand up and stand out to an influential audience. Learn more at ctpublic.org/sponsor.
Support comes from Hancock Shaker Village, featuring 20 historic buildings, demonstrations, workshops, art exhibitions, and fall events, including a country fair on September 28th and 29th. Open daily from 10 to 5. HancockShakerVillage.org.
Support for arts and culture reporting on Connecticut Public Radio comes from Yale Institute of Sacred Music, the Hartford Symphony Orchestra, and Blythewald Mansion Gardens and Arboretum. Listen for reports on Morning Edition and All Things Considered.
This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Frankie Graziano. This hour, we're doing a deep dive into immigration. Earlier, we talked about some of the misconceptions. Now we'll talk about some of the very real challenges immigrants face when they reach the United States. Joining me this morning, Maria Sacchetti, reporter for The Washington Post, covering immigrant communities and immigration and customs enforcement. Thank you so much for being on the show today, Maria. And Charles Venator-Santiago, associate professor with a joint appointment in the Department of Political Science and El Instituto, Institute for Latino, Caribbean, and Latin American Studies at the University of Connecticut. If you've immigrated to the United States, if you're part of the diaspora, maybe you are somebody like me who's second generation, we'd love to hear about your experience. Give us a call, 888-720-9677. 888-720-9677. Hey, we're going to do a dive into pathways to citizenship. Charles, what are some of the hurdles immigrants face in Connecticut and abroad as well?
So the economy, it's a hard place to live because the cost of living is really high. However, Connecticut, unlike other states, has a little bit of support. For example, we have Husky Health, which is a big sort of support, although immigrants are facing this challenge of getting public access to public health. We had an amendment that allows kids up to the age of 15 to receive public health. They're subject to discrimination in public housing. Landlords pick at particularly undocumented immigrants. Jobs don't pay enough for the cost of living, particularly. There are problems with linguistic justice. There's not enough translators or interpreters available. And then there are other sort of day-to-day issues around lack of housing, lack of transportation that make it hard for immigrants to sort of settle.
Can you button up that conversation, though, on Husky? Because there's been a lot of discussion in the last few years about broadening that access to Husky for undocumented immigrants.
Well, it's a public health issue. If you have a sick labor force or children who are sick, they can't contribute to the economy, and they can potentially contribute to spreading more illnesses.
What's the access to Husky for undocumented immigrants?
So right now, children up to the age of 15 get access to Husky Health.
Thank you.
And that was an amendment that was passed in last summer from 12 to 15. But immigrants are saying, please raise that age up. The other option is for people to go to emergency rooms, which is fairly expensive, or some community clinics.
And I think some of the conversation there was to expand the age up to 26, just as you would have, because I think Husky, you're eligible up until you're 26 if you're like a traditional resident of Connecticut here for a long time here. Where do each of the presidential candidates stand, Maria, on the topic of citizenship? Do they have plans to improve that process?
I mean, that's a very kind of a complex question. I mean, that's okay. I mean, I mean, the Trump administration, you know, I mean, they naturalized a lot of people. I think you mean like giving citizenship to undocumented immigrants, right? More than 11 million people in the country. And I think, you know, Trump wants to deport them. He thinks they should leave. Some have been here for 20, 30 years. And Kamala Harris and Biden before her, you know, both believe that that people should, you know, have a path to citizenship, that they should be able to apply for it. I think, but they haven't expended a lot of political capital on that. I mean, it was one of the first things Biden did was file a bill that would make people citizens, and they haven't, it's been pretty dead the entire time.
What about with the Trump administration and the backlogs? We could all agree that there is a backlog and there are very real challenges at the border. How are they talking about the backlog?
Well, I mean, they're pointing to the backlog as one of the issues in this country. I mean, you can't get a fast response to your asylum claim. And they're concerned that a lot of the asylum claims are not legitimate. And from what you're seeing, you know, people are not eligible for asylum. To be eligible for asylum, you have to have a well-founded fear of persecution for a very specific reason. It can't be general, I'm afraid of crime in Venezuela, or I'm afraid of the government in Venezuela. It has to be that you're a target, that you could be killed or harmed if you're sent back to your country for your political opinion or your race or nationality. And so it's a difficult case to win. It's one of the reasons a lot of people don't win. And so that backlog is an issue. I mean, the backlog can be, some people, you know, will at least have, you know, the argument is they'll be able to stay for a long time. So it gives them a foothold in this country. But, you know, there's a real question about what kind of future you'll have. You know, like right now, we hear so much about DACA and Dreamers and what's the future of those folks. But the reality is the kids in high school right now are going in, you know, wishing they could go into college, are not eligible for it. You're basically back to where we were, except for this pool of maybe 500,000 people who, you know, where kids who are in high school aren't eligible for any kind of the protections that DACA offered. So it's a really serious situation for the undocumented immigrants in this country right now.
I think that's an important point for Charles to address, because you're talking about what happens now at that next level, because we've talked to a Connecticut public, many Dreamers that want to go to school. So what are some of the challenges you're seeing, Charles, then in the United States or working in the U.S. after graduation?
Well, you know, bringing it home here to UConn, I have a ton of brilliant DACA students who, because their process was suspended in 2022 or paused, haven't been able to normalize their status. And I can admit them to the graduate degrees or to the university, but I can't give them financial aid or federal aid or work possibilities to work as a graduate student or to work as a teaching assistant, because they don't have a normalized work schedule or the ability to work. And that's terrible, because we're seeing DACA students graduating from undergraduate degrees in Connecticut State Colleges who can't continue graduate education and potentially contribute in more ways to the local economy.
We have a caller here. We're going to sneak you in here quickly, Diane, because we got a couple of more things we got to cover before we let Charles and Maria go. Can you just give us your thought here quickly, Diane from Willimantic? Good morning.
Yes, good morning. A symbiotic solution: people who need jobs and an elderly person like me who needs someone to help. Get them trained, get each of us screened. That person can help me. I can help them get on their way. And for able-bodied people, the huge housing economic issue, get them working on affordable housing projects if they need jobs, and jobs need to be done.
Charles, I think you were kind of alluding to this earlier. Can you address what Diane just said?
No, the problem is getting access to the permits that allow them to work. I mean, some people are working. There's an informal economy here, but people are not necessarily making enough. And when they go look for housing, landlords take advantage of their fragile status and engage in all kinds of discrimination. So we have a systemic problem that could be addressed locally in some ways, but these are also federal laws. I can imagine a Connecticut state that creates a number of exceptions for undocumented immigrants, starting with driver's license, access to public health, in different kinds of ways, in more creative ways, housing protections, and simply incorporating Latino immigrants or Latin American immigrants to the state of Connecticut, which account for a fifth of the population and are becoming the largest labor force in the state, as we see an aging white population.
Former President Donald Trump told Time magazine earlier this year that he has not ruled out building detention camps on the United States soil for migrants in the country illegally. Is that a real fear if he wins this second term? We're still talking about detention camps in 2024.
Yes, I think so. The idea that he's harping on is this idea of the so-called wetback or Operation Wetback, which is to deport all the Mexican immigrants that were brought into work during World War II and who had settled to make up for the labor shortages given the war, or at least World War II. And now he wants to amplify that argument, in my opinion, in a very racist way and in a very non-discriminant way. Now, again, part of the problem here is that Congress has not allocated enough funding to create detention centers that could facilitate this transition, and it refuses to have. And now the solution that Trump is proposing is to create these sort of detention camps that can be used to essentially deport possibly 11 million or maybe more people.
What about any quick response to that, Maria?
I mean,
based on what you're hearing?
There's no evidence that the United States has the capability or the permission of other countries, which it needs to put people on a plane to those countries, especially at that volume. I don't see that they have the money, the personnel to do it safely. And you can't, the other country has to agree to facilitate the deportation. They're supposed to do it. They're supposed to take back their own citizens. But a lot of countries don't, such as, China often has a history of not doing that easily. Venezuela, certainly, and other countries. So that's one issue. There already are detention centers. They can house. We saw in the Trump administration it went upwards of 50,000 people a day. But certainly, as Professor mentioned, you could expand that. You could create camps and things like that. And that is something, and Trump hasn't ruled out separating families again either. And so that has also been a question.
What about Kamala and Vice President Kamala Harris and the President Joe Biden? Where do they stand on family separations, or at least trying to prevent them?
They abhor it. They say it was a terrible thing, but they are deporting families too, and they have deported people to Haiti directly, even though they say that's a country that's too dangerous to deport people to. So that speaks to, I think, the mixed feelings about the border influx. Biden said before he took office, he and Harris campaigned on the most progressive immigration platform I've ever seen. As the numbers started to tick upward at the border, and that happened before Trump left office, a lot of people forget, that he also, offered protections to Venezuelans before he left office. That started to concern people that it would create a political crisis that would hinder the administration from achieving other things like citizenship for people who have been here a long time. So you have millions of undocumented people from Mexico. And by the way, most Latinos are U.S. citizens. Most Latinos are not immigrants, right, anymore. And so, which is always so important, not just Puerto Ricans, of course, but most in this country. But you see, so many people coming in, and yet you have a lot of people who have been here for a long time. They sent their kids to college. They own houses worth a lot of money, some of them in California, and they just can't get their status sorted out.
This is The Wheelhouse. I'm Frankie Graziano from Connecticut Public Radio. Tremendous testimony there from Maria Sacchetti, the reporter from The Washington Post. Thank you so much for coming on the show this morning, Maria. Good luck covering this divisive issue during an election. God bless you. And the University of Connecticut professor, Charles Venator-Santiago, thank you both for coming on The Wheelhouse. Good to see you again, Charles.
Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
After the break, more myth-busting. But this time on the local front, we shine some light on changes to your most recent electric bill. Thank you to Robin Doyen Aiken for that pun. I love puns. Call us if your new rate has you irate. That's another pun. 888-720-9677. 888-720-9677.
Support comes from the Palace Theater in Waterbury, presenting Hades Town, the new Broadway musical from Aeneas Mitchell and Rachel Chavkin, intertwining two mythic tales of love that span worlds. Coming October 3rd through 6th, more at palacetheaterct.org.
Vice President Harris's proposal to give $25,000 to first-time homebuyers. Is it just a Democratic giveaway? Well, maybe not. A similar program is championed by none other than Florida's Republican governor.
I'm not a huge fan of Ron DeSantis, but I thank him for putting me into this home because I wouldn't have been able to get in there without him.
That's on the next On Point.
Listen this morning at 10.
Bethany Butler's book, Black TV, looks at the history of shows that center Black characters.
None of these shows exist in a vacuum. I feel like every single one is important and a stepping stone to where we are now.
This week on Disrupted, we explore representation on television. Join us.
Listen this afternoon at 2.
Support for Connecticut Public Radio comes from People's Bank, where a team of experienced local bankers is committed to making commercial and business banking simple because life is complicated enough. Bank at peoples.com/business team.
This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Frankie Graziano. State recently approved another rate increase on electric bills for customers using Eversource Energy or the United Illuminating Company. Its rate hikes went into effect on September 1st. This announcement came at a hard time. Many consumers are already expressing frustration with rising costs. This morning, I'm joined by Dan Haar, who will help us understand why rates continue to go up and how the state is responding to worries from residents. How are you doing?
Great. Great to be here.
Good. You can fix your mic if you need
to. Wait a minute. Is it too low? There we go.
You could do that.
What are we on?
I think you sound great. Can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Oh, that's good.
What medium are we on?
We're on TikTok. We're on the radio. We're on everything.
Okay,
you know, we're doing a lot.
Good.
I think we're stretching you here a little bit, but you're going to kill it.
No, this is it.
Has your energy bill gone up? Has my energy? I got to check my energy bill up. But folks, if yours did go up, did it make you want to blow a fuse? Do you have any questions? You want to stop hearing our puns? I like puns. If folks want to connect it to local politics, Dan's going to help us do that. Give us a call, 888-720-9677. Hey, we want to get into the rate creases in a moment, but we got to start with the why over the what here. Why are we dealing with rate increases? When did this start? The whole thing, even the millstone thing, too.
Well, the crisis of this summer was the cause overwhelmingly of hot weather.
Yeah,
and so the numbers, and I don't want to overwhelm the viewers and listeners with a lot of numbers, but the average usage in July for Eversource residential customers was 949 kilowatt hours, right? Now, that's up from an average over 10 years of 868. And that's up from last July of 835. So we had a low year in 23, then a high year in 24. So you might say, well, those are big numbers, but that doesn't explain for people saying, oh, my bill doubled and I was paying $2,000, right? And it does not, in fact, explain that. So the part of the reason is that the increase for the public benefits portion of your bill went up by about 6 cents. We could quibble about cents, you know, 0.2 or whatever, but it's about 6 cents that it went up, right? So that difference there accounts for about $56 of your bill, right? Just that one difference, the 6 cents. But your rate went down from the first 6 months of the year, so that should have made up for a little bit. What's really happening here is something called the tipping point.
The tipping point. I want you to get into this for point. Yeah, let's get to it. Yeah.
All right, you want to get to the tipping point now or later? Okay.
I just don't want right don't expose me as somebody who's past that tipping point, but go ahead.
You're not past the tipping point. No, you got the bright future. So the tipping point says that the numbers we have here show that the average bill in July was 273, up from 221 a year ago, and up from what would have been 191 without that millstone-based increase, right, which we've all talked about. Okay, so those are big numbers, but they're not the huge numbers that we were hearing about. The huge numbers are because of the tipping point, which is that people who are accustomed to having they have a God-given right to have their house be at 68 degrees 24 hours a day from Memorial Day to Labor Day, right? They're seeing a tipping point because they're not changing the way they live their life, i.e. their air conditioning usage for the weather, right? They're not being a little hot during the day. They're just using air conditioning. And then they get their bill. Oh, my God, it's the fault of Eversource. Well, it isn't. Right, so they've gone over that tipping point, and that explains the really irate users.
I like that you use irate because we used that as a pun earlier. 66 degrees for me, but only at night. 66 degrees for me, but only at night. We don't use it during the day. Does that help, kind of?
If you got it, you got to sleep.
Yeah, you got to sleep. 66 degrees, I got to have that. You're working on a column that says year over year, July 2024 wasn't so cost prohibitive.
Well, it's
to 2023.
2024 was
$56, as you outlined earlier. Can be really hard for somebody. I'm just saying, like, yeah, just help us out.
Yeah, there are a lot of numbers to keep in mind. The bottom line is that your usage is the thing that determines the overwhelming size of your bill, not public policy. The public benefits portion of your bill, on average, at Eversource, and it's not too dissimilar at United Illuminating Downstate, was about $56 of your bill. The bill in July of 23, on average, was about $221 versus $273. That's not a difference that we like paying, but that's not the reason for the summer of heat in energy policy here. The reason is people used way more because of that tipping point.
So you already talked to us about the tipping point, which is important. So we have the public benefits charge that added a little bit to it. We also have the change in the millstone rate. I think it went up like a half a cent per kilowatt hour. What was the number from the deal that we have from 2019? What's the...
Well, the 2019 deal says we're going to guarantee that we're going to buy their power, half of their power at 5 cents a kilowatt.
5 cents a kilowatt hour.
And by the way, as Governor Lamont reminds people, we made about $200 million in the first couple of years of that deal, and we may make more in the last 5 years. We are 5 years in. This past couple of years has not been good. We're, by the way, on track to about break even on that because it's a simple hedge. It's like any other hedge. You're buying something for a fixed price. If the price on the market is higher than that, you win. If the price on the market is lower than that, you lose. And so it's a hedge against super spiking prices. When prices spike, we buy it at 5 cents and we make money.
So lawmakers, I believe, have politicized that. I have that correct?
No question. And there are a number of swirling issues here, and we haven't gotten to wind. Maybe we will get to wind, right? Wind accounts for an amount of your bill that we don't know. Right now it's small, but these contracts coming up could increase your bill significantly. I just did a little back of the envelope. Here's my back of the envelope.
I love that. Thank you so much.
These upcoming wind.
He's got a white paper with some blue pen writing on it for the folks.
Try to read it. You can't read it. Right?
Mine's worse. My handwriting.
This is my quick list. But all kidding aside, these upcoming wind contracts, which have also been in the news because Governor Lamont balked on signing these contracts, unlike Massachusetts and Rhode Island, which signed them, they could increase your bill by quite a lot. I thought it was trivial, and I just did the numbers. Depending on how much wind we buy and what the price is, it could be a 5% increase on your bill just from these contracts. It, again, just back of the envelope, one of the problems here is we don't have the numbers.
So there's more. That was a column that you could see on Hearst Connecticut Media. What's the website? It's
CTInsider.com.
You could find Dan, who's the senior editor there and a columnist. Terrific work. We're still going here. We got to talk about the lawmakers, though. So help me with Vinny Candelora is the minority leader in the House.
Yes.
What's he saying about it?
Well, what he's saying is
electricity.
There are a number of things he's saying. He's saying that it's outrageous that these bills have been able to go up and up and up under Democratic control. What the Democrats remind him is that it was Republicans, not overwhelmingly, but Republicans strongly supporting the Millstone bill, right? And that's the piece that we just talked about, that's the $56, right? Now, why are rates going up overall? It's 1,000 cuts. It's a lot of different things. One of the things the Republicans oppose is that we are paying the bills of people who can't pay in larger measure since COVID. Right. And that accounts for somewhere between $80 and $150 million this year on the bills, which accounts for a little piece, but it's not the biggest piece.
And Ryan Fazio is also talking about this. He's a state senator out of the
Greenwich.
That's the Greenwich area. Yes.
Greenwich. That's right.
What's that? CT 36 or 37?
I think that's 36.
36. Yeah.
The 37th senator used to be the chief of staff there.
I'm having a hard time. Right. There's 36 senators. Thank you.
Names.
That's a great civics question.
There
okay. So Ryan Fazio, really quickly.
Yeah. What he's saying is that there needs to be a long-term thought out program here. And he's not the only one saying it, but he's bringing a rational rational approach to this from the Republican side, which I think is admirable.
But Democrats are saying, hey, we could make out over the long term, and they're saying you agreed to this.
By the way, specifically what Fazio is saying is, let's not pay triple for wind power. Let's wait till the price comes down.
And you say he's always been into clean energy, too.
Yeah. The problem, he is into clean energy. The problem with that is that if you don't pay for wind power, as the state of Connecticut, who does? And if you don't pay, if nobody buys wind power, the technology doesn't improve and the price doesn't come down.
What's your next column going to say in 30 seconds? Can you help us, or at least promote it for us?
I don't want to tip the competition.
But you're going to be following up on wind. That's the next thing we should watch.
I'm going to be following up on a breakdown of what it is you're paying for. Right. I will say this. Governor Lamont, no matter what he does, gets criticized. And there was a certain columnist who criticized him for balking on those wind deals, which I know for a certain fact, had the governor signed those deals, that same columnist, a former state senator, would have slammed him for being blind. That's the reality.
The most controversial man in local columns is Dan Haar. Hey, he's happy. I'm happy right now. The Yankees are four spots ahead of the Orioles in the playoff race.
And
Mets are two games ahead. We're happy right now. Who knows what's going to happen? Columnist, senior editor with Hearst Connecticut Public Media. Connecticut Media, sorry. I can't help it. Dan, thank you so much for stopping into
Great
the Connecticut
here.
Public.
Great to be on.
That's it for today's Wheelhouse. We got an announcement. I said it on social media. Next week, oh man, we're kicking off our candidate interview series. We're going to be live streaming on Connecticut Public's YouTube channel. Hear from incumbent Congressman John Larson, Democrat in the Hartford area, and his challenger, Republican Jim Griffin. You can submit your questions now. Yeah, that's right. You can ask the candidate some questions. Wheelhouse@ctpublic.org, or you can call us live next week. Today's show produced by Chloe Wynn. Man, did she do a great job today. Edited by Robin Doyen Aiken. Our technical producer is the maestro Dylan Reyes. Joe Koss and Bradley O'Connor manage our live stream. Graphics for our live stream created by Sam Hockaday. Thank you to Julianne Verace as well. Thanks to Tess Terrible and Megan Boone for helping us in studio. Meg Dalton oversees the production of The Wheelhouse, also supported by Megan Fitzgerald. Download The Wheelhouse anytime. Thank you to Francesca Fontanez as well. On your favorite podcast app, I'm Frankie Graziano. This is The Wheelhouse. Thank you for listening. See you next week at 9 a.m. Start of the candidate interview series. Tune in.